How is your mom now?
Alhamdulillah, she's good. She's getting better. But at that age, you know, it's up and down. She's 90. So, yeah. But she's good. Yes, what can I do? You frightened me there. I think it's just to pick up the mic. Am I right?
Yeah.
Right, okay, that's fine. Cool. That's fine, though, not a problem.
So, Shabbi, the other day, of course, we caught up briefly. I don't know if you've been following what has been happening at the park with some of the debates we have been doing. Essentially, one of the crucial points we are trying to get to is to establish the fact that God of the Bible, Yahweh, Jesus, is of course not at all the same as Islamic Allah. They are polar opposites. And that is a prime theme that we are trying to advance, just so Christians could be clear, Jews could be clear, that Islamic Allah is not the God of the Bible. And likewise, Muslims like you also, some of the sincere ones, could also be clear in seeing, of course, God of the Bible is not Islamic Allah, and therefore that could give you a chance to get to the God of the Bible. That's our motivation. And that is where I brought up this point about Sharia versus Torah. And my main point there isn't to deal with the jurisprudence, not the law, but rather to establish the nature of God. And of course, one of the things that show up as part of the nature of God is morality of God. Yeah. So that's the background to...
I understand. So, right, not a problem at all, Arul. The issue here is that when we had our conversation a few weeks ago, I was very particular about the words that were being employed with you. And I even asked you, I said, Arul, are you talking about the legal elements? And you said, yes. I said, okay, well, if that is the case, then we ought to include the New Testament also, because there are legal elements in there. However, and also you were very clear that it's the Torah and the Quran. But from what you have just said now, I can fully understand that what you are saying is that no, the Bible collectively, the Quran or Islam, let's basically say Christianity and Islam, okay? From my angle, yeah? What you are saying, Arul, is that look, how the Creator is perceived in Christianity and how the Creator is perceived in Islam is the issue here that we need to address.
Yes.
Yeah? Excellent.
The characteristic of Islamic Allah versus Yahweh.
Right, okay.
Moral aspects,
right.
Morality. Thereby, my ultimate point is going to be Yahweh is not the same at all with Allah. They are polar opposites, different gods. You might, if you follow some of the Soko Films videos, you'd already see that Muhammad, I think he's a sheikh. Sorry, I don't know what sheikh means, but he is someone who's supposed to know a Quran. And he,
oh, brother Muhammad, the Arab.
The Arab.
With the glasses.
That's right.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And he clearly agreed.
We never claim, Muslims, we never claim that Allah is Yahweh.
Perfect.
We never claim this.
Good.
Yeah, we never claim this.
Good.
For you to know.
Excellent.
Excellent.
We never claim this.
And then subsequently, we also had another debate with him and then also with Shamshi.
Yeah.
And there they agreed that Islam is nothing but human reaction to situations that we might get into. Nothing to do with supernatural
right.
elements in terms of knowledge.
Yeah. So well, actually, can I just address that? I think you are being unfair to Brother Shamshi. I did watch that. Brother Shamshi said something to you and in your 3 minutes, you then said what he had not really said. He was explaining to you, and I don't want to go too much into that, but that was a conversation between. But I can say, if you have a look at the video again, you are being somewhat unjust to him. He was actually saying something else, but you, you concluded, Arul, what you thought he had actually said when he hadn't really said that.
So,
but leave that aside.
Yeah, so just to remind quickly, Shabir, ignoring the word used, the point was, his point was, of course, if you are in trouble, you can lie. That was his point.
Uh-huh.
And that is what he qualified as
right, okay.
a normal human reaction.
Okay.
Now, use any other word you might want to use. Mm-hmm. My only point there is, when it's, of course, regular human reaction, especially when it comes to lying, which goes against the commandment of God, what I'd say is that's, of course, not of God. But you are right. I wanted to suggest a particular theme today in regards to the Torah versus Sharia. And the particular theme was in relation to keeping oaths. Oaths, covenant, keeping contracts, contractual obligations.
Keeping agreements.
Agreements.
Okay.
Sticking to an agreement.
OAPHS. Yeah.
Oaths. I know.
Friends, it's okay.
I know my friends are totally understanding
my
accent on that. I do apologize. Yeah, so keeping an agreement in that regard, if we can again compare and contrast Yahweh with Islamic Allah, and there my conclusion is going to be again, Yahweh obviously is polar opposite to Islamic Allah.
Okay.
And so hopefully you could also agree, like Muhammad,
right,
Sheikh, you could also agree today.
Yeah.
Of course, they are not the same. They are very different.
Right. Okay. I can see your proposition, but I'm going to put my proposition forward. I told you then and I'll tell you again that from my perspective, the Creator by definition can only be one. So the very idea, the notion that there's a different God in the Bible and a different God in the Quran is alien by the very standards of the books themselves. Okay? So there can only be one Creator, and if there's any polar opposite, using your wording, if there is any polar opposite, then it would be due to the misunderstanding of one party and another. It certainly is not because there seems to be more than one God. Yeah. So if we were to look at it the way we had agreed initially, we were going to look at the Torah and we are going to look at the Quran. Now, I actually had suggested to you, brother, look, do you want to include the New Testament? Because it was legal elements. It seems like the discussion now has taken a slight diversion from what we had originally agreed. I don't mind if that's how you want to take it. But what we should be discussing, if we are going to talk about the nature of the Creator, then it has to be in totality.
Yeah, not restricted. The Bible. Yeah, so
apologize. Not restricted to a particular aspect only. That would be unfair.
Oh, no, in the interest of time. We haven't got much time. How much time have we got?
Arul.
45 minutes.
Arul, in the interest of time, I agree with you, but to come and then change the very basis of the discussion is being somewhat disingenuous.
I do apologize if it comes.
Apology accepted.
Thank you. But we can work out a good way forward.
I hope
Shabir.
So.
My point is, if we take, so my point, just so we are on the same page again, my point is, I am suggesting that I'd like to compare Yahweh of the Bible with the Islamic Allah,
okay,
and especially by taking this element of what their specific take on, Islamic Allah's take versus Yahweh's take on keeping an oath, keeping a contract, keeping an agreement, what their specific take on this particular thing, and there my conclusion is going to be, obviously they have a completely different stance. And based on that, if we could come to any conclusion in the next 45 minutes or so, if we add anything to that, I'm willing to do anything on top of that, maybe on another occasion, but just in the interest of time.
No, in the interest of time, I have no problem with that, Arul.
Cool.
My concern is that if in a period of 3 weeks you've already changed the goalposts, then I am expecting goalposts changing in the conversation itself. Again, I don't mind. Yeah. At the end of the day, we are here to try and establish certain things, and that is what we want to do. So, yes, I have no problem with that if you want to take that approach. But one thing I am saying again is that logic will dictate that there can only be one Creator. So if you are going to talk about the difference between the approach of the Creator in what you call the Bible and the Quran, I would suggest to you that the only difference that you will see, this polar opposite, is in the understanding of what the contents of the two respective books say.
Yeah. I'll make just one last remark before jumping onto the specific subject, purely because you're making this point again.
Yeah, sure, sure.
The point is, I do appreciate there's only one Creator. Only one. And I think that is the God of the Bible.
You said two.
No, I think that is only the God
at
of the Bible.
At the start, Arul, you said
though,
two.
Unfortunately though, people think the Quran or the Quran has a revelation from the Creator, or in other words, Islamic Allah is the Creator. People think that is the case, people like you, and there are many other well-intentioned people who think that way, and that is why I am bringing in the challenge now to say, no, no, that can't be true. Obviously, they are different, and we have reasons to trust in the Bible because there is supernatural revelation there, but there is none here, and therefore, the one creator has to be the God of the Bible.
Yeah.
That would be my logical flow.
But
for now,
yeah. That's
keep
fine.
Goats.
That's fine. What we'll do, Arul, we'll have a conversation.
Yeah.
But one of the things I'm also going to say is that you are making bullet points which ought to be discussed to establish whether they are valid or not. For example, you just said there's a supernatural aspect to the Bible.
Yep.
Okay. We need to discuss it whether there
Absolutely.
Is or there isn't.
I'm willing.
Now that's a different matter altogether.
Absolutely.
So what I am saying is that look, in the interest of fairness, I would suggest don't bring in aspects which they themselves require a discussion on, and then follow that basis and then lead to a conclusion.
Cool.
That's being unfair.
I'll leave that for
so
later,
what I would suggest,
later
yeah,
discussion.
Yeah, what I would suggest we do here, we want to talk about the understanding of what the creator is. In terms of the oaths, it's a very loose word you have applied, but I'll go with it anyway and we'll proceed.
Yeah, cool. And did you want this to be particularly timed, or I'm willing?
No, it's better a conversation.
Okay, cool,
I prefer it that way. And cool. You will find me not interjecting constantly. I will never do that.
Okay.
And I hope you don't do the same.
Yeah, I'll roughly stick to something like maybe 3 to 5 minutes on the first introduction is going to
go ahead.
I'd like to set the context properly.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah? So to set the context properly, I'm going to read one particular verse from the Quran, which is Surah 66, Ayah 2.
Can I have the
Surah 66, Ayah 2.
Yeah.
It says, Allah has made lawful for you, i.e. Muslims, absolution from your oaths. And Allah is your protector. He is the knower, the wise.
Mm-hmm.
So here, of course, the context, it's a wider context in relation to Muhammad and his wives. A few things were happening.
Yeah.
Now, those things in themselves have available for a longer discussion. My focus is not that. My focus is purely on the keeping of the oath. And here, my point is Allah, Islamic Allah thinks people can have absolution from their oaths. That's something he thinks is legally valid. You can agree on something and then later think, you know what, no, I don't agree on that for whatever reason. That is what Islamic Allah thinks.
Okay.
Legally.
Right.
And as a matter of fact, yeah, so that's what he thinks legally.
Okay.
Now, if I were to contrast that against the character of Yahweh of the Bible, I see a completely different thing there.
Okay.
What I see in Yahweh of the Bible is, Yahweh of the Bible is someone who keeps his word, period. No ifs, no buts, no revisions at any later date. When he says something, that is what he says.
Can you give me an example?
Exactly. I'm going to go there exactly just now. I can read to you scriptures.
Yeah, yeah.
It's going to take a few minutes. So I don't know if... So one second, please. Let me read to you a passage from 2 Samuel, chapter 21, verses 1 to 14. Just give me 1 minute. Let me get that. I was hoping to have my Bible with me, but I need to stick to
one,
my...
One second.
Yeah, sure.
Hold this.
Sorry.
No. Right. Give me 1 second, Arul.
Yeah.
Hold. Which one do you want?
No, I want my notes, my Bible. Sorry, 1 second.
Why is your Bible? There's no difference.
No, I have my notes on them. I have
Oh,
yeah,
okay.
That's the only reason.
Okay, not a problem.
So, yeah, cool. So,
can I just ask which version this is?
No, that's that. Why is that?
There's no harm in you telling me. Which version is this?
This one. Why do you ask, Shabir? Just so you know.
I'll tell you why.
Yeah.
So that I can understand.
Yeah.
which one you are using and whether there's a difference with the ones that I use.
No. In terms of content, they'd all be the same.
No. I'm asking which version is this.
So the translation that I use.
Arul, respectfully, it's simple. Yeah. Is it the King James? Is it the New International Version? Which one is it?
The translation I use is what is called the New King James.
Excellent. Thank you. Yeah. It was simple. Why did you have to try and go all the way? You know, I'm not going to try and trip
Shabby,
you up. Don't worry.
You are a very knowledgeable man, and you know.
You are entitled to your opinion.
I genuinely think that yeah. in terms of some
Please,
of things,
yeah,
some of the
sure.
points you make. But the point is, you should know about the park. And in the park, Muslims have been incorrectly advancing this idea that different versions actually mean different Bibles. And I don't for a moment say you, someone as qualified as you, would yep. make that kind of point at all. But I'm just suggesting other people do. And I didn't want your statements yeah. to be misconstrued. That's the only no. reason I hesitate
but
to answer your...
Before you do that, Arul, you see, respectfully, yeah. you must accept the majority of the people who are misconstruing Islam are that sister there, what is she called?
The refugees.
Hatun, the other brothers also. However, the position you must accept, yeah, that when the Muslim says about the versions, you've got to accept that because I've got two right now. You will. If
Shabib,
I can, one second. I didn't interject. Please let me finish. And it's only valid that if the Muslims are saying their versions, here is one, and here is another, and here is another. You've got to accept that this one is not the same as this one, and these two are not the same as this one. In, you know, when you use the word translation here, this, respectfully, is not a translation because these have got more books. This is just as a side point, because it would be unfair on the Muslims to say that they are trying to misconstrue things when the truth is that there are more books in one than the other. So anyway, carry on.
Shabib, you have sneaked in a few points which are completely incorrect there. Which you shouldn't. I didn't expect you to do that.
I didn't do anything.
And this is
of
why
the kind.
I hesitated in answering your previous question. If you wanted, I can have a lengthy discussion with you on Bible and its text. Just because you on camera spoke over my sister Hatun, I should make
I'm
this
saying
point.
That.
I should make this
yeah.
point. She is my dear sister,
and I don't
and,
have any problem
and,
against that.
And in as far as what I have heard her say at the park, yeah. I don't think she advances any wrong idea. Mm-hmm. She might come about, she might make points in a way which you might not like, but still which are true points which are useful for others
okay.
to hear. Now,
according
and I,
to who?
I don't want to argue yeah. about
no,
that.
I
she is a dear sister. I just don't want you to disrespect her.
Arul, I will not.
Now,
if it came across, I take it back. You know, but what I said to you is that, look, when you are talking about the Muslims,
if you,
the
Shabir,
versions are there.
Shabir,
so
you must
carry
remember,
on,
like I said, the one reason, the very important reason I said you must know, you would know your stuff, is because I'm sure you would be following what's happening at the park. And you would know, not long ago, the very same Hatun you mentioned about brought in 30 different Qurans to the park. 30 different Qurans. If you want yeah. to have a long chat about that, I'm willing to have. But that's not what we're talking about now.
We'll do that.
By all
so
means.
There's no.
So there are 30
no
Qurans.
Misconstruance
and there
here.
Are a few translations
there's
of the Bible.
Only one
Let's
Quran.
Get to
no,
the.
No. Don't worry. That's usual. Let them. It's okay.
Shabir, let's stick to the point.
Exactly. I'm trying to.
Now, you were
Stay
the one
away.
Who were asking me about version and this and that and then sneaked in a few points.
You
wanted to tongue in cheek. You wanted to make a few remarks.
Arul.
You are the one who did that.
Arul, do you accept this?
What?
As a Bible.
Well, it seems like.
Do you accept it?
Well, that seems like.
Would you
like
take teaching from it?
Well, the Bible, yes.
Would you take this one?
Shabib, what's
there
the
you
object
are.
Of
Thank
our
you.
Discussion? What's Be- our
no,
object
no.
of discussion?
Arul, you see, I said to you at the start, brother, if you are going to... No, I said it very
Shabib,
clear.
Shabib, I am a Christian.
I am not...
Shabib, you're making a few points which
Arul.
I'm not happy with, Shabib. I am a Christian. Take the number of books in the New Testament there. 27 books. Jesus died, came back alive. You carrying any Arul. Number of those books isn't going to help you at all.
The same
every single
brother,
Bible,
brother, brother.
Every single
die.
Bible you can have access to at the park. Jesus died, came back alive. Jesus claimed to be God. He was worshipped as the Yahweh of the Old Testament. That is what you would find. Doesn't help the Islamic agenda. Let's put an end to that there.
Arul.
Let's move on to the topic
Arul.
Of discussion, please.
Arul.
Shabir, Let's get back to the topic.
I'm allowing you to speak.
Allow
me to speak. But what I'm
going to... This is a diversion already.
It's not at all. You start... You look, am I going to... Are you going to allow me to...
I started. Arul,
I was silent.
Nazeeb, did he not ask me what version I'm using?
Arul, listen.
Did he not do that?
Arul.
How can you say I started it?
Arul, brother,
you
listen.
You had a mighty go about other Muslims.
Brother, please,
when
brother.
When he said...
He's kindly talking
sister,
to me. Brother.
With respect... You brother. Disagreed with him, started slanting.
Yeah, brother, wait, one second.
So, that is
cut
true.
Out. Not
thank you.
Cut
no,
out.
No, no, don't worry. We keep. Yeah, thank you.
Cool.
Look, Arul. I have not interjected when you spoke. Don't. I said to you, Arul, at the start that, look, if you are going to bring points, I'm going to have to respond because that would be unfair.
One second. I was looking for a Bible. You were the one who went there.
Arul, you are taking advantage of my kindness now, aren't you? I'm not interjecting when you are speaking. Please give me the same respect. I said to you, when you brought about, you said, look, oh, I wanted my Bible. I went and I pulled them out. I said, oh, which one? Okay? I didn't mind. Because look, as a Christian, and you emphasized that you are a Christian. As a Christian, you tell only the truth, don't you? You do.
Which is what I have
you
done.
Do. One second. You do. So when I'm asking you truthfully, do you accept this to be the inspired word of God? Your answer should be yes. But what I'm saying to you is simple. As a Christian, you can't lie. You can't deceive. That's what you are telling me.
Cool, Shabbi. I think we've
gone on a tangent. One second. Again, you're interjecting. What I am saying, my position about the Muslims here was that, look, they are only being fair that they are different versions. You brought up the 30 Quran one, not a problem, I don't have an issue at all. But what I am saying is, if we are going to do something, let's do it properly. So, you have brought 2 Samuels, yeah? Now, is that part of the Tanakh?
Why are you asking me this now?
Look, isn't it part of the Bible?
It is.
Now,
why are you asking me now?
I'll tell you why. Because when we had our conversation, it was to do with the Torah and the Quran. My view, and I'm saying this, that we do it the right way. You are directly going into the verses, okay?
Yep.
Without having established whether what we have has any element of truth. So, if...
There
one,
we
one
go.
Second, let
Shabbi,
me finish.
Shabbi, I'm beginning
let me
to
finish.
See deception
me,
already here.
Let me finish.
I'm really beginning to. Shall we
Are you
get
going to allow me to finish?
About what? We have a topic.
Let me finish my conversation with you in a civilized, decent manner. That's what Muslims are supposed to do. I'm doing that. What I was about to say to you, you didn't even know and you automatically assumed. I was about to say to you, look, I am sticking to the script we agreed, the Torah and the Quran. Logic tells me that, look, the first thing we have to do is establish, as you are a Christian, yeah? I know, I'm aware and I'm sure you are aware that the distinction, before we go into whether the verse says this and the verse says that, the distinction that is made by the Jews and the Christians in relation to how many books are the canon are different. Do you agree?
Shabir.
You don't agree.
Shabir.
Yes.
I haven't interjected you now. Am I hearing you right? Are you essentially saying in a debate that we just began a few 10 minutes ago where we were going to talk about keeping oaths, are you saying we must now discuss the canon first and get to this? Is that what I'm hearing from you? Is that really what I'm hearing from you?
Are you asking me?
Yeah, I'm asking you.
I said to you, I'm trying to keep to the script we agreed, but I will follow you through if you want to talk only about the oaths. But there's one very important thing, Arul, you're missing.
The canon.
No. If you are going to relate a verse, doesn't logic tell you and tell me that we have to establish the validity of that statement first?
In other words, the veracity of the manuscript.
Do you agree? Should we establish the validity of that verse? Because if
what
we are...
What do you mean the validity?
I thought so. I'll tell you what I mean, Arul. Look, if I am going to accept this readily, yes?
When you say accept, what do you mean?
Wait, I'm trying to explain. Okay. If I am going to accept this readily as it is, should I accept it as the word of God in totality?
In other words,
no.
You are now first trying to advance the idea of whether this is canon or not, which is what I said earlier. You said no.
No. No.
What do you want to do now?
No,
this
I'm,
is the
I'm
Bible.
Not doing anything.
So, you, in other words, what I see you do
right,
is
Arul,
a very simple thing.
I'll tell you what.
Shabi,
I
what
think
I see you do is a very simple thing, which is,
sorry.
We began with a simple topic. I thought you were genuinely going to engage with me on that topic. If you had said you weren't prepared for that topic and you wanted us to debate that later, I am fine with that. If that is what you had said, I would be completely fine with that. But that is not what you're saying. What you're rather saying is, I'm assuming, and here I can only guess, to me it seems like maybe you're not prepared to debate on the particular topic. Maybe you're not ashamed, you're ashamed. Maybe you can't defend the Islamic Allah. And therefore, you're trying to extend our conversation even before we come to the subject that we thought we were going to discuss by talking about all sorts of other things like canon and so on. That's my perception. I could be entirely wrong. Just prove me wrong, Shabir. I really was expecting something much better from you.
Very easy, Arul. You see, it actually has just shown that you are not listening carefully.
Okay.
Because when I started, I said, look, Arul, you have come and you have changed the goalposts. In normal circumstances, anybody who does that ought to be told, look, go away, no discussion. I didn't do that. I was considerate to you. Number two, I also said to you, look, if we were going to talk about that, yeah, now you want to talk about oaths when you are asking the brother there. And I said, well, if that's the case, okay, we'll go with that. No
Torah
problem. One second. No. We'll go with that because you had now, the word Torah had just disappeared when you started. I am the one who introduced it because that is what we had agreed to have a conversation about, Torah and Quran. Now, I'm still saying, look, no problem, I'll go ahead with it. But what you have missed totally, you give me a verse and I said to you, I don't agree with it. How do we proceed?
What do you mean don't agree? Do you
exactly.
mean I don't agree that
now,
that verse doesn't exist in the Bible? Is
no,
that what you're saying?
No, what I am saying to you, Arul.
You don't agree that that should be in the Bible?
You allow me to speak? Arul, you see, my method is different. And I'm sure you will have seen the videos. I look at the evidence and then we assess the evidence. Okay? You gave a verse from the Quran and you said it was the polar opposite to what the Bible says. And I said to you, okay, give me an example, and you are going to Samuel. Okay? Now, I am saying to you, look, don't I, and you tell me if I'm wrong in the way I'm thinking, don't I have the right to ask you, wait a minute, Arul, I can see as a Christian you are going to Samuel, but I am thinking, is that part of the Torah or is it not part of the Torah? If it is part of the Torah, fine. If it is not, problem. But if then you are going to insist on reading it, I can easily conclude that this has nothing to do with the Creator.
In other words,
how do we proceed?
In other words, your excuse now is,
no, I don't have an excuse.
Let me finish now. Your excuse now is, if I pull out verses from the Bible to demonstrate that Yahweh of the Bible clearly is polar opposite to the Islamic Allah, your excuse is going to be, oh, I don't trust in this Bible. That's your excuse.
Are you asking or are you telling?
I'm telling you. That's what
well,
I'm
telling
perceive
you, you are
from
wrong.
What you're saying.
You are wrong.
To prove, I'd be happy
wrong.
To know I'm wrong. Prove to me why precisely you don't even want me to read the portion of scriptures I wanted to read.
Excellent. You see, I never even stopped you from reading them. What I did say, I preempted you and I said, look, the verses you are going to read, okay, don't I have a right to establish whether they are from the source that you claim? That's all I was asking. Now,
one second,
Arul.
Here,
I know you are.
They are from the
one
Bible.
One second.
If that is what you
Arul,
mean, that is from the Bible.
You told me you
what
wouldn't interject. You would not interject.
No,
Arul,
you're making
listen,
points which
rest,
are not advancing
listen, Arul,
anything here.
Arul, I am only saying to you that at this point in time, you are saying you are confused.
I know I'm not confused, but you seem to make points which are thoroughly
confusing to you.
And therefore,
okay,
there is some problem somewhere. That's what I'm trying to imply here.
There is a big problem, but I tell you what, I think that the understanding here is at cross, yeah, at cross purposes. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to allow you to proceed.
Good, thank you. So Shabir, by this time, I think many people might have forgotten what I was saying, trying to say earlier, Quran.
No, you were saying from
Quran,
Surah 66.
I read 66
you
verse
read about to him releasing people
66,
from the oath.
66 verse 2. Islamic Allah things, people going against their oaths could lawfully happen. And in this particular case, it's not even lawfully happening through the will of, through the motivation of the people involved, but rather of Islamic Allah himself. Islamic Allah is introducing that lawful deviation, lawful absolution. In contrast, I'm going to read to you a passage from scriptures, the Bible, 2 Samuel chapter 21 verses 1 to 14. The first few are the important bits, the first few verses. The rest are just so you get a historical context right. Now there was a famine in the days of David for 3 years, year after year. And David, King David, inquired of the Lord, of Yahweh. And the Lord, Yahweh answered, it is because of Saul, King Saul, and his bloodthirsty house, because he killed the Gibeonites. Because he killed the Gibeonites. And the context of this essentially is that if you read Joshua 9, chapter 9, verse 1 to 7, let me give you a brief outline of the history there. Gibeonites are part of Canaanites. When Israel had to march into Canaan, they had to wipe out all Canaanites. Now, the moral aspect of that, I'm willing to have a debate on that on some other occasion. Right now, the point is, Israel were asked to do a particular thing, remove them from that land. But what ended up happening, Gibeonites, which is one particular group there, they had deceived Joshua. They deceived by saying, oh, we're not really from here, we are foreigners, we are just here briefly, we are foreigners. So Joshua was misled to think that Gibeonites weren't Canaanites and therefore weren't part of the people group he was supposed to eliminate from the land. That was the context. In that context, Joshua was willing to make a covenant with the Gibeonites. Without verifying with God, he made a covenant, and that covenant was, you're not part of the people who I was supposed to wipe out. You are here, you're saying you're foreigners, fair enough. I would leave you behind. I would leave you behind alive, and you can live under our protection. That was the oath. Later on, he got to know that Gibeonites were really from Canaan. Later on, Joshua got to know, not long after that, he got to know they were really Canaanites, at which point now he had no way to trace back his oath, the covenant, and therefore all that he could say was, I gave you a word. I know you deceived me. Even though you deceived me, I have no way to go against my oath. In other words, Yahweh does not allow absolution. That was what happened in the case of during the time of Joshua. Fast forward, come to King David's time. What is happening here? King David got to know there was famine for 3 years, and the reason for the famine was the people to whom a covenant was given by Israel, the Gibeonites, were killed. Some of them were killed by King Saul's house. Enemies, wicked people, all those things. But a covenant was given, and because a covenant was given, here, when the covenant was breached, Yahweh says, I'm going to punish Israel. Keeping a covenant is very important for me. In other words, simple point, Yahweh wants people to keep their word at all times, no matter the circumstance. Islamic Allah willingly, for simple things in life, just to have one more lady here, one more lady there, thinks you can be absolved from your oaths. And this is a very, very scary thing to me. When you get married to someone, I'm assuming Islamic Allah would want you to keep the oath. But it seems like that is not the case. That is my challenge. Polar opposite. How could these two at the same time be God? Obviously, they can't be, is my challenge. Shabir, I'd invite a legitimate way, a reasonable way from you to respond in saying, How can you resolve the polar opposite attributes of the true God of the Bible versus the Islamic Allah of the Quran?
In response, because you are going quite lengthy, I think we should reduce it a bit so we can have an opportunity to have a conversation. Okay? But in summation, you are saying that the whole of the Bible tells you very clearly you must not go against your oaths. Whereas according to you in Surah 66, according to your wording, willy-nilly, it doesn't say that, but since you use the word willy-nilly and you use the example of marriage, yeah, all the while you are speaking, I'm thinking to myself, I thought Brother Arul would logically apply himself to the conversation, and hopefully you will do that, yeah, but I don't look at it that way. You see, you have taken one verse, yeah, and it is like that's all Islam says. It doesn't. There are many instances, yeah, as Muslims, and I'm sure you will be aware, where we are told, okay, we must not lie, we must not cheat, yeah. You can Google it, you don't need any. You must not cheat, you must not do this. Be just, even against your own self. Now, that's Surah 4, 135. I'm asking you this, Arul, because I did say when we started, apply reason in so many words, yeah. When it says I have to be just against myself, yeah, and I have an oath to do something with someone, and I willy-nilly, according to you, break it, am I being just against myself, or am I being unjust against myself? I'll ask you to think about that, number one. Number two, you see, this conversation that you have brought, in a nutshell, okay, we can end between the polar opposite of the Bible creator and the Quran creator. My view is the creator is one, and everything that the creator does is consistent. If there is inconsistencies between what is contained in the Bible and in the Quran, then I can confidently assert that the Quran, as in Surah 5 verse 48, tells us very clearly that it is the one that oversees everything that had come prior. Then if there is any misunderstanding in here, it is the misunderstanding that we need to remove. Now, if I were to say to you, right, listen, Arul, yeah, your reasoning is that everything that the Bible contains is all about justice, all about truth, all about...
Sorry, I'm listening.
No, I don't speak to people who are doing two things at the same time.
No, I'm listening. Shabir, you must...
Are you
listen.
Sure?
I am
okay.
listening.
I'll carry
yeah.
on then.
Yeah.
yeah? You see...
I'm
because,
taking notes as you're speaking.
Not a problem.
Yeah.
You see, because I know that as a Christian, from Genesis to Revelation, you must accept everything, okay? Yeah. So, when it tells you that you must keep your oath no matter what, yeah, in your conversation, I think it was with Shamsi, yeah, you made it very clear that look, you are told to deceive, yeah, because you referred to Surah 3, okay. This goes to the heart of what you are saying, because I'm not only talking about oaths, yeah. Let's, like I said to you, let's cut the chase. Let's look at what one basis can demolish the whole edifice, okay? So I would say to you, look, if I was looking at the Bible, okay, and you tell me that you must keep your oaths no matter what, yeah, I would suggest to you that look, as human beings, the Creator gives us the guidance, and the guidance is for our benefit, not for the benefit of the Creator, unless you believe that God can come down as a man. That's a different issue, okay? So I would ask you, Arul, if I were to tell you that, look, the agreement or the oath, yeah, especially in the context of Surah 66 that you brought up, and you are aware of it because of what had happened between the prophet and the wives, okay? In certain circumstances, if me and you have an agreement and you breach the agreement, am I entitled to nullify it?
Is that a rhetoric question?
No, I'm asking you.
So now, is it my chance?
No, no, no. And you see, I said a conversation. And in a conversation, like when you asked me a question, I answered and then I proceeded. Yeah, and you proceeded also. One second, Arul.
Please, go on.
I told you we'll have a conversation. So I'm asking you now, yeah, that if me and you have an agreement, okay, and you break that agreement, am I entitled to also break it?
I'm not sure if that's relevant.
I thought you would say that. So let me go forward. Okay, so what is happening here is this. If I were to say, look, according to my understanding of the Bible, okay, the Creator, according to the Bible, the contents are replete with the Creator himself being quite deceptive, yeah? Him deceiving, forget about human beings. Now, I would ask you that, look, I've given you the explanation about the verse you brought up. The 2 Samuel one, I'm saying to you, look, if I were to kindly ask you to go to the book of Ezekiel, chapter 14, verse 9. If you can go to that and let's just read it so that we know where we are. If you can just please. Yeah? I'll hold it for you, so if you want.
I'm assuming somewhere down the line you're going to reconcile the attributes that we just spoke about.
Oh, yes.
Ezekiel?
14:9.
Ezekiel 14:9.
Yeah.
And if the prophet is induced to speak anything, I, the Lord, have induced that prophet, and I will stretch out my hand against him and destroy him from among my people Israel.
Okay. When it says, I have induced, what does the word mean?
Sorry, Shabir. I'm not here for a Q&A. I'm not here for an interrogation. I'm here for a discussion. I have raised a challenge. I'm going to give you time for you to make your points.
I made it.
Have you made that? In which case, I can go back.
One second, Arul. I told you, I am not going to have... One second, Arul. At the start, I made it very clear. In all honesty, Arul, this conversation, I'm only allowing. Yeah? And I'll tell you. I am saying to you that when the verse is telling you something, okay, I am suggesting to you that particular verse is very clear. It is talking about the Creator deceiving people. Very clear. The Creator is saying, one second, the Creator is saying, I deceive. Now, what I said to you is, look, you can do that as much as you want. The point is, I'll read it for you, okay?
Brother, can you just hold this?
Thank you. Yeah?
By all means, you can read and make your points, and then I'll jump in with my response.
No. I would expect you to respond to my question like I did to yours.
I'll come back with my response.
Yeah.
Jump in.
Okay.
Good.
Excellent, that is. Now, I have made it very clear.
Sorry.
Yeah? Can you see me? Am I handsome enough?
We're fine.
Okay, then. All right, okay.
Within the limitations of 10.
Right. 14, verse 9. Yeah? It says, I am Jehovah, and when the prophet is inveighed so that he speaks a word, I, Jehovah, have inveighed that prophet. What does the word inveighed mean? Can we Google it, please?
No.
The word invade.
One second.
Arul, look. I think what you need to understand, what you understand in a conversation, Arul, you have your way of doing things. Let me have mine. Don't impose on me. All I am saying to you is, look, the whole basis, and I did say that, the whole edifice can be demolished if I can prove to you, using only one verse, that the Creator, according to the Bible, deceives. And if that, one second, if that is the case, then anything you subsequently say has to be justified in the context.
Let me finish, Arul. Have you found it? What does it say?
Persuade someone to do something by means of?
Of what?
Deception.
Shabir.
Now, whoa. Calm down, Arul. Look, I am saying to you, The word is very clear that this is what, according to Ezekiel 14:9, according to the Bible, God personally deceives. Now, in one of the videos, you made it very clear to whoever you're speaking to that when they refer to Jeremiah, oh, no, it wasn't God directly deceiving. Well, this particular...
I'm willing to have a long conversation with you
Arul,
about deception.
Arul,
I'm willing to have that.
Right.
But today,
Arul,
not that.
Arul,
we're talking
Arul,
about keeping oaths.
Arul, you are...
Simple.
Arul, no, no.
Sticking
Arul,
to
listen,
your word.
Listen,
simple.
listen. You said... Oh, sorry. You said to me, you've come with an agenda of what the discussion should be. I said to you, look, are we going to include the whole of the Bible? Yes, we are going to include it. Now, how I'm making the point, and I made it clear to you, that look, when it comes to the ideas of deception, breaking of oaths, etc.
They're not the same.
One second. If I can finish, Arul. For you to use the Bible is virtual suicide, respectfully. Now, why I'm saying that, I'm using this verse, as I told you, you know, when you talk about oaths, yeah, these are legal elements. Okay, I will give you an example and I want you to follow this through. Yeah, the rabbis, okay, collectively established 613 commandments. Okay, 248 were positive, 365 negative. Out of that, number N294, it says, according to their understanding of the Torah, very clearly they say that if a person commits a sin under duress, they are not to be punished. That they have gleaned from the Bible. The question I would ask is, if their understanding of the Torah is that if you commit a sin under duress, it is not to be considered a sin. If you are forced to lie, according to them, you don't get punished. Now, I'm saying to you, if you use the Bible to try and justify how just, for want of a better word, the Creator is, then you are committing virtual suicide. Now, I'm asking you, according to Ezekiel 14:9, you talk about oaths. I'm suggesting to you that the very being that allegedly is telling you to keep your oath is himself, I'm using the word himself, telling you that he deceives people. Now, I'm asking you, Arul, a simple question. According to Ezekiel 49, if you agree with me that yes, the Creator is saying he deceives, then anything else that he says has to be taken with a pinch of salt. Do you agree?
Shabir, is it my turn now?
Your turn.
Good, thank you. Shabir, I thank you very much that in the 5 minutes or maybe 10 minutes of your response, I do not see, apart from the last half a minute or so, I don't actually see a proper response to the point that I raised, which is keeping oaths. Duress is the only explanation I saw there, nothing else. And you, of course, because you couldn't answer the question I am raising, you're going all over the place, bringing in the idea of deception. I'm willing, by the way, I'm very, very willing. I had that with Shamsi the other day. I'm willing to have a debate with you, Shabir, on deception, Islamic Allah versus Yahweh. Very, very open. Let's do that maybe next time you're here. Let's try and do that. But that is not the point of conversation here. Muhammad with his wives, no duress involved, even if you think duress is an excuse. Here we're talking about his wives, no duress involved. The point was about a simple oath, and Muhammad, Allah, I'm assuming you would think, Allah doesn't go through duress from anyone. And therefore him, I'd expect him to uphold a superior moral quality, which he doesn't seem to. He legally sanctions absolution from oaths, which is something which Yahweh does not do, even if it means a few people are going to die. Gibeonites, the point I raised, the point was Gibeonites, Canaanites were supposed not to be touched purely because an oath was given. Now let me go back to a few points you raised. Thankfully, Shabir, quite early in the conversation, thankfully, you said we could end the conversation here because you said obviously Islamic Allah is different from the Bible.
I didn't say
the
that.
I'm interjecting.
No, Arul, okay, I will end this conversation now. do not put words into my mouth which I have not said. You did that with those two brothers. I noticed. One second, Arul.
Yeah, viewers, one second. Again,
one second.
The point you made.
Look, the viewers, I appreciate and I respect the viewers, whoever they may be. But what you are doing is being very conniving, and that is not very Christian-like. Okay, let me say
Shabbi,
one second, Arul. One second.
Here. Let's get back to
and
my.
Nor are you my judge. Let me say what I want
and
to
I
say.
And I never judged you. I let you make your point when you were making points.
Listen. I said to you at the start, I want a decent conversation. You are making too many snide remarks and I am aware of them. One second, let me finish, Arul. I don't come here to have these kinds of banter. I come here to have a reasonable conversation. Now, you must understand something you seem to not be able to understand. If I have given my response...
Yep.
One second, no. When I have given my response, it is entirely your decision to say whether I answered it or not. However, after I have given my response, I asked a question. That is what you should respond to first before you go on to your other points.
That is what you are dictating.
No. It's only reasonable.
Shabbir, I let you speak. Can I speak now? It's my turn. You just seem to be offended.
No, I'm not offended. So, I just think you are being very conniving.
Thank you. Let everyone judge. Sure. Let people judge, and let an overall I'm God not, judges overall.
Are you doing
Shabbir,
this? Are you doing this for the people or for us
Shabbir,
to understand?
Shabbir,
come on.
Why did you bring the cameras?
Hey?
Why did you bring the cameras?
Why did you wait for the cameras?
Because I want people to listen.
I don't want to do that, but in a reasonable way, not
Shabbir,
like
Shabbir,
this.
Let's not do this. We don't.
Right. Can you just go ahead?
So, go anyway, ahead. And yeah, all the deception.
Don't worry about us. Worry about you.
No, that's
Carry
fine.
On.
So, you, somewhere in your response, you essentially said, we could end the conversation here. And you said, if the Quran goes against the Bible, which seems to be the case here, Islamic Allah legally sanctions absolution from oath. And here in the Bible, Yahweh thinks, even in the worst of your situations, you still need to keep your oath. That seems to be the polar opposite difference. And you suggested, when we encounter such a difference, the only recourse you would have is to suggest that the Quran is the one which supersedes. You said the biblical revelation has been superseded by the Quran. According to the Quran, I think you mentioned Surah chapter 5, I think. That is what you said. I didn't put words into your mouth. You can check out your recording. That was your explanation. I'd like to thank you at least for saying that you haven't got any other valid explanation for the fact that there is polar opposite characteristic between the Islamic Allah and Yahweh clearly showing up there. You then also went on to make a remark about the Quran talking about us having to be just and so on and good and so on. You made that at the start. My problem is this. If a person makes 10 truthful statements and 2 untruthful statements, by simple convention of language and practice, we'd call him a liar.
Okay.
Not a truthful man.
Okay.
The moment you have one immoral attribute, and in this case that being absolution of oaths, i.e. not having to keep your word, if that is what is coming from Islamic Allah, we could go through all other attributes a bit later. The moment we see this, we already see an immoral Islamic Allah,
okay,
who can't be reconciled with the Yahweh of the Bible. You also said Islamic Allah might have suggested this. I don't think you made this point quite in this way, but you were talking about whatever Islamic Allah said was for our benefit, not for his benefit, not for the benefit of the creator and so on. Absolutely, that is not the point here. I'm not asking who benefits from what. All that I'm asking is, what is the characteristic of Islamic Allah versus the characteristic of Yahweh? Islamic Allah seems to be quite casual with, even for simple things about this lady and that lady, even for simple things like that, he seems to be quite all right with people not keeping their word.
I'm sorry,
and
Arul,
I'm saying Arul. Yahweh does not allow that to happen.
Okay, no problem.
In other words,
one second, Arul.
I'll come.
You are taking too much time.
But making sensible comments.
Not at all.
They
are illogical.
Islamic Allah.
Can we just please restrict it?
Opposite to Yahweh.
Okay.
You haven't given a reasonable explanation as to why this is the case.
Can I?
I could suggest. Can if you just give me one moment.
No.
I could suggest why this is the case. One minute.
No. It's my.
I could suggest why this is the case, and the suggestion that I have is. The God of the Bible, with all his signs and wonders, is the only true God who cares about morality.
Yeah.
Islamic Allah, on the other hand, doesn't seem to have a proper standard of morality.
Yeah. Okay.
In this particular case, not caring to stick to his word.
Okay.
Therefore, I earnestly invite you to come to the one who has a superior moral standard, Yahweh.
Excellent.
Islamic Allah would not even keep his word in regards to you going to heaven. Forget about him.
Right.
Come back
to
Jesus.
Okay. Now, you see, Arul, you made so many points, but the ones that I would really like to respond to are the ones that are appropriate to the conversation. I said to you very clearly, my coat is getting heavy. Right, Arul, you see, you said something quite important. Yeah, you said if a person tells eight truths and two lies, you, according to your standard of the Bible, would consider him a liar.
Normal convention.
No, I was going to come to that. One second. And you also said that, conventionally speaking, that is how one would be viewed. Okay, no problem. I asked you, and I even told you, and I'll repeat it again just in case you missed it. When you referred to that particular surah, I then said in response, look, in surah 4:135, this is what it says about how we have to be just even against ourselves. Now, what you seem to have totally missed is that if there is any issue about the suspension or the absolution of oaths, there is a specific reason to it. I think it totally missed you. I then referred to N294 of the 613 commandments as evinced by the Jewish scholars. They say that it is not a sin if you are going to be accused of a sin which was done under duress. Now, I then said to you, wait a minute, Arul, if you are saying eight truths and two untruths makes a person by convention a liar, I then said to you, okay, Ezekiel chapter 14 verse 9 says that God directly deceived. Now, one second. God directly deceived. I'll read it again for the purposes of clarification.
Show me one person in the Bible who God deceived.
Calm down. I didn't interject. Now I've told you very clearly. I am asking you, and I get, brother, is there a problem? Are you talking to me or are you talking to him?
Okay,
that's fine. Ezekiel 14:9. Brother, I know I'm disturbing you, but can you just pull up the word invade again? Right? And you see, now it will make sense to you when I said that, look, if we wanted to end this conversation with one statement, and there are a few others which I haven't even referred to yet, one statement here, chapter 14, verse 9 of the book of Ezekiel is very clear. Okay? I want you to tell me, when it says here, I am Jehovah, and when the prophet is inveighed so that he speaks a word, I, Jehovah, have inveighed that prophet. What does the word inveigh mean?
Persuade someone to do something by means of deception or flattery.
Now, does it say here that the Creator, Jehovah, according to the biblical understanding, deceived this particular individual? Yes or no?
Shabir,
It's a simple question.
But
yes,
irrelevant to the conversation
Arul, one second. I'll tell you how it is relevant. You need to expand your understanding. Yeah? You see, Arul, if according to your understanding and your view, which you hold strongly, Arul, you said very clearly, a person who says 8 truths and 2 lies conventionally is called a liar. I'm saying, listen, you are referring to 2 Samuels, you are referring to how oaths must be held to. I'm saying to you, wait a minute, how in the world are you trusting something where the very author is saying that he is a deceiver? Now, I'm asking you a simple question. According to this verse, Arul, does it say God deceived this person? Yes or no?
Shabir, is that your turn?
No, I'm asking first and then I can go forward. Yes or no? Is it saying...
My response, Shabir, is clear. Yahweh of the Bible, I have read my Bible carefully, right through, and I can challenge you, God of the Bible does not deceptively act. Period.
Okay. Arul.
Period.
Arul.
Now, can I suggest that's an ocean.
Arul, my friend.
You can hide in,
Arul,
which I don't want to happen.
Arul, you have drowned in it. I am not even hiding.
That's
listen
fine.
To me, Arul.
Can we please
listen,
come back?
I have come back. I don't think you are conceiving of what I'm saying. I'll simplify it a bit more. Listen, Arul. I said to you, if you are going to accuse or rather suggest that the Quranic creator, okay, allows willy-nilly, according to you, to break oaths, I'm saying, wait a minute, I have explained to you, are you familiar with the 613 commandments as evinced by the Jewish scholars? Are you familiar with them?
I am.
You are. So N294, where it says very clearly, one second, where it says very clearly that, look, if a person sins under duress, they are not to be punished. Now, you see, Arul, you need to expand your thinking. What I mean by that is that there are going to be reasons or certain actions that are going to be undertaken by people which were forced on them. So, for example, if somebody forces you or puts you under pain of death to deny the Creator, and you deny the Creator, are you found guilty according to N294? The answer is no. I know you will not respond. Okay? Now, I'm asking you a simple question, Arul. According to your standard, this standard of keeping oaths even to death, as you said, I'm asking you a simple question based on that. According to the very same book, which is talking about the God that you believe in, which is apparently polar opposite, in Ezekiel 14:9 is saying very clearly, he deceives a person directly. I'm asking you a simple question, Arul, in the context of this moral aspect, do you agree that according to Ezekiel 14:9, here, I'm reading it, it is saying God deceived this particular individual? Yes or no?
Which individual?
Do you want to read it? I thought you've read the Bible.
Here, I know. Which
I'll read
individual?
It again.
Do you have a specific
I'll read
name
it.
There?
I'll read
please,
it, I'll
please
I'll read it again. It actually says, I have deliberately deceived the prophet.
Which one?
Does it matter now?
It really matters.
Oh, excellent. Let's go
because,
back.
Because you see,
excellent.
This
excellent,
is what
excellent.
Samshi did the other day.
No. Excellent.
This is what Samshi did the
excellent,
other day.
Excellent.
He brought in a case where God hadn't deceived excellent. Anyone, but because Samshi can't read beyond a particular word, not the entire statement.
Excellent. The whole thing here is about what? Prophets.
Which
false prophets?
Which ones?
Here, false ones. Okay. Now, I'm asking.
So, which
you,
particular prophet
one second,
is
one
that
second,
talking
one
about?
Second. What? Do you want the context as well? No problem.
Which particular prophet is he talking about?
I'm so glad you are asking me that. It means you have taken actually a step forward. Good.
Now,
one second.
I'll let
my
you
friend,
finish, and then I need
my
to
friend,
move on now.
No, here it is. It is taking you and some of the elders of Israel at chapter 14. Start. Okay? It talks about them. You carry on reading it. Here is the classic issue which you are now trying to...
Have you got
one
an
second.
Answer, Shabir?
I'm giving you
which,
the answer.
Which prophet I'm, was deceived?
I'm giving you the
Please
answer.
Please give me the answer.
I am giving you the answer. Okay? I am telling you here, when it comes all the way back to here, the question that is being asked and you are now trying to avoid is simple. I... Can you read yours as well?
No, Shabir.
Read yours
I'm
as well.
I'm
come
not,
on.
I'm not,
oh, come
I'm
on, Arul. Come
I'm
on.
Here.
It is a very important issue.
I'm not here
issue.
To play
okay,
some little games here. I'm here to deal with serious
moral issues. I'm trying
moral
to, but I think
issues.
Brother Arul is having
Shabir,
a problem.
My challenge moral, in that regard...
It's a moral issue. I'll tell you what.
Have you finished now?
One second. No, I asked you a very simple one. Three times I'm asking, and I'll ask you again. Okay? The whole of the chapter is there. You can read it as well. I'm here. I'm telling you where it is talking about. I, Jehovah, am going to reply to him. I, Jehovah, have deceived that prophet and will swing my hand over him and rout him out. The question you are asking, well, listen to your logic. I'm saying to you, wait, whether it's James, John, Jesus, Muhammad, Arul, Shabir, whoever, the issue is not that. The issue is, does it say that he, God, is the one deceiving? Yes or no?
Is that an end of your term?
No, I'm asking a question.
No, you're asking me many questions.
I haven't asked you. I've only asked you one. Does it say here? Does it say here? Because you are not answering. You keep going all over.
No, you make your points and then let me respond. Please,
Arul, you have been accustomed to having these kinds of discussions. I don't have discussions like this. I said a conversation, and part of the conversation is that when a question is asked, like you had asked me, I responded to it.
I never asked you such questions. I presented to you a case for you to respond.
I'm saying, okay, I'll tell you what, in 2 points. Number one, I gave you a very clear indication of what the Creator is saying to us. If you want to misconstrue it, that's entirely your decision about the Quran in Surah 66. So, okay, one second, let me finish. Yeah, I now am saying to you, look, whatever basis of morality you seem to hold as being superior from the Bible, I am saying to you, look, according to the standards of the Bible, everything, unfortunately, is a total fail. Why? Because this verse here, which again you still are resisting and coming out with, which prophet that? No, the issue is not who the person being, who the person being addressed is or ought to be. The issue here is a simple one, and I'm going to ask you one last time, and I hope you have the courage to answer. It says here, I, Jehovah, have deceived that prophet.
Can you give the definition again,
now,
please?
Can I ask you, one second, can I ask you, do you agree that here it says that Jehovah deceived?
So, Shabir, the definition he brought up before us, persuade, not deceive, persuade to do something.
Yeah.
That's the definition, not deceive. Mm-hmm. Persuade to do something by means of one of two things, according to this definition, one of two things. One of them is deception and the other one is flattery. That is the definition here. Now, if you want to run... Now, excuse me, Shabir, I am now answering before...
I'm not saying anything.
Good, thank
answer,
you.
Answer,
if you would
answer.
Listen, please.
I'm listening
my
to
point
you.
Is this.
I can do two things at the same
the
time
reason,
also.
The reason I asked you for the name of the prophet there is not because I wanted to find who you think Yahweh was deceiving, but rather my point was, because we disagree on the definition, on the meaning of the statements that you are reading, I wanted us to go through the illustration of the example for us to clearly see Yahweh of the Bible does not deceive. There was a particular case I had a discussion with Samshi, where the illustration involved false prophets, Yahweh himself, true prophet, and a king. If you take every single entity involved in that conversation, which Samshi thought God was deceiving, none of them was deceived.
Right.
Every single one knew that a lying spirit had gone out with lies and had spoken to false prophets.
Okay.
Every single one of them knew.
Yeah.
No deception involved. Samshi could not even read the context entirely. He was sticking to one word here, one word there. And that seems to be what you are doing there. And that is where I wanted an illustration. Anyway, my point is this. The explanation you have given, what I wanted to discuss about today was about keeping oath. And the point there is, Yahweh of the Bible sticks to his word no matter the cost.
Arul.
No matter the cost.
Sorry,
Islamic
Arul.
Allah.
What are you saying? No. Hey, come on, you are not being fair now.
Islamic Arul, Allah, on the other hand.
Arul, let's go back to the word
Surah
in vain.
Surah 66, verses 1, 2, 3, if I
could
read.
Let's go back to
prophet,
the way.
Why prohibit you that which Allah has made lawful for you, seeking to please your wives? What duress is involved here? No duress is involved. I'm not saying under duress you can lie. I'm not saying under duress you can break your oath. I'm not suggesting that at all. Yahweh never suggests that to happen. But all that I'm saying is, purely because you brought duress into the picture, I'm just clarifying to you, clearly there is no duress involved. This is a domestic issue between a man and a couple of his wives. That seems to be the problem. No duress involved, right, unless you're going to suggest Aisha threatened to kill Muhammad. Or some other wife of Prophet Muhammad threatened to kill him. If that is what you're going to suggest, that's fine. Allah has made lawful for you, legal for you, absolution from your oaths. And Allah is your protector. And it goes on to say, when the Prophet confided a fact to one of his wives, and when she afterwards divulged it, and Allah informed him of it, he made known part of it and passed over part.
Yes.
The point here is, if you both turn to Allah repentant, what is repentant according to him?
Yeah.
Not having to keep your oath is repenting.
Right, okay.
To me, that's a weird definition of repentance, and that is a weird moral character.
Yeah,
which is of God.
Okay.
And therefore, my suggestion,
right,
Shabir, is instead of you trying to get all your dictionaries
I'm willing to have a long conversation on whether
Yahweh of the Bible is a deceiver or if Allah is the greatest of deceivers, Islamic Allah. I'm willing to have that long conversation, but not today. The point today is keeping oaths, Islamic Allah, doesn't care to.
Right.
He advances the idea of not keeping it.
Okay.
Yahweh wants people to keep it.
Right.
He is the only true God. Islamic Allah either does not exist or is subhuman in moral character.
Arul, please stop preaching so much. Okay, listen. I said very quickly, we are going to conclude now. I think it's, all I said to Brother Arul was, if the foundation is totally destroyed, then anything above it is just a pie in the sky, respectfully. Now, this one? This one? Okay. Now, here is what I said. Brother Arul tried, he tried a quick one, and I don't blame him, he had to. He quickly asked you to bring up the thing, the definition. And he then used the other words, apart from deception, he used the other words which, according to him, may apply to that. And I said Ezekiel 14:9. I'm going to read it again. All I want you to do is respond now, okay? It's a very simple thing, okay? It says here, and if the prophet be deceived and speak a word, I, the Lord, have deceived that prophet. Now, do you agree that the word here is deceived?
The word used here is
but deceived.
The statement is much wider than the word, and the meaning of the statement must be understood in the context of the passage.
I'm so glad. You see, you must do it in the context. You must do it in the context.
Yes,
One second. When it comes to Islam, as I had said earlier on, I said, look, you need to understand. Just reading like this doesn't work. However, what you cannot escape from right now is, does it say here, God deceived the prophet? Yes or no?
No, it's a wider statement.
Does it say God deceived according to this?
No, it's a wider statement.
Let me read it again and tell me if my English is correct. I, the Lord, have deceived the prophet. I, the Lord, have deceived. What does that mean? I'm asking.
Can you please make your point?
I, the Lord, have. What does I, the Lord, have deceived?
Can you please make your point?
Arul, I'm asking you a simple question. It's English. I, the Lord, have deceived. What does it mean?
So, if I...
What does it mean?
Shabir, let's not play simple games here. The point, the fact of the matter, Shabir...
Respectfully, I would say one thing. Go and learn a bit more and then we'll have a conversation.
Thank you very much.
Yeah,
but Shabir,
because... one second.
That's fine.
Because, Arul,
I'm willing...
Because,
I've asked a simple question
and all I want is a simple answer before we conclude. Does it say, I, the Lord, deceived?
That's not the nature of any conversation, Shabir.
Does it say I, the Lord, deceive?
Shabir, thank you. A simple point here is that you don't seem to know how to read a statement in its context. Now, obviously, we disagree on this particular regard. I challenge you for a detailed debate. And when we do that, I encourage you to bring examples of a few people who God Yahweh deceived, and we could deal with those detailed cases.
Respectfully, you have said something very sensible now. Listen, you know what you did?
I'm not asking you for your comment evaluation. You seem to jump up and down in terms
of
evaluation.
I followed you. I'll go with you. Okay. Yeah, I said to you, Arul, you have come up with a very good idea now, honestly.
Can we please finish up what we are doing?
We've already concluded God is a deceiver according to the Bible.
The conclusion
That's the end
is
of it.
Islamic this Allah one? Does yeah. not keep his word.
Yahweh, you are entitled
the
to that
Bible
opinion.
Keeps his word. This is not my opinion. This is straight from your Quran and straight from my Bible.
How can it be when Ezekiel 49
no
says he deceives?
Come involved.
On. Yeah. Okay.
About
no
deception,
worries.
I'm willing to have a long conversation.
No. I'll tell you what.
When we do that, Arul, by all means, bring an example of a person who Yahweh deceived, and then we can see what the nature of the dynamic involved is, and then talk about that.
Okay, I'll tell you what we'll do, Arul. I'm going to conclude. Look, I respectfully would say that anyone who has, and I don't mean this about you, anyone who has any logical approach, an intelligent approach to subject matter, would actually address the matter in detail rather than doing what our brother here just did by referring to one verse. He didn't pay any attention to the verses I had brought up, which clearly are potentially conflicting, but it means that you need to understand what and how oaths ought to be administered. Okay? Now, I can say very clearly that, look, if you are going to take the Quran as the basis for understanding, then I would equally want to take the Bible as a basis for understanding, In that regard, I said to Arul very clearly that according to the Bible, it's very clear. I read the statement from the Bible that God deceives. Now, if according to the verses, and there's only one, there are many others we can address. But what I would not want to do, as Arul has done, is just take one, sometime totally out, and he did refer to the context, totally out of context. I do know one thing, that if we have a detailed discussion, subject matter chosen and subject matter will be abided by, rather than what Arul did quickly, came here and changed the whole goalposts. I forgive him for it anyway. Yeah. At the end of the day, I can have with you, Arul, a detailed discussion, debate, call it what you want, on a subject matter, and I can confidently assure you, you will agree with me that the Bible ought not to be the book collectively as guidance for humanity.
So should we?
So what I want you to do, Arul, agree with me a particular topic and don't change it midway.
You changed it totally when you came.
We had agreed legal elements. The video is up.
Yeah, and you
came.
Can check up the video. Nature of God is an expression.
I said it should have been a collective one. Yeah, I'll tell you why, brother. You see, he went specific. I honestly can take this and ride with it, hold it. But I don't want that. We want to come to a common understanding.
Worst case, there has been a misunderstanding. Possibly,
no, not worst case.
But best
no
case.
No misunderstanding. You changed the goalpost.
I disagree with you.
You are entitled
morality,
to that. Yeah.
Torah versus Sharia, nature of God, Yahweh versus Islamic Allah.
Right.
Are the statements, are the expressions I used. You can check up the video later. But if you have a grievance I'm willing to concede
Arul,
by saying, you know what?
Arul.
In a communication between human beings, there is a chance that things could have been misunderstood.
Not at all.
I am willing to have a more detailed sort of definition this time.
Yeah.
But just quickly add, let's read this.
What have you done now?
What does Yahweh say? Ezekiel 14, 8, 9, 10. I will set my face against that man and make him a sign and a proverb. I will cut him off from the midst of my people. This is in regards to the one you think Yahweh intends to deceive. What does God say? I'm going to judge him. Even before you get to verse 9, he's talking about him judging him. I'm going to cut him off. Then you shall know that I am Yahweh. And if the prophet is induced to speak anything, I, the Lord, have induced that prophet, and I will stretch out my hand against him and destroy him from among my people Israel. So this is a dealing with false prophets. I'm willing, next time, if you wanted to get into the details of this, I'm willing to debate this in detail.
Arul,
but that is what we find here.
Look, Arul,
but
Arul,
respectfully, Shabir.
No, you are being unjust and unfair again. Look, I'm going to make this very simple, and then we will discuss it. Very quickly, I said to you, God deceives. I read the verse. One second. Whether there is context to it, whether there is X, Y, and Z reason for why God was justified, because that's what you are effectively saying. God was justified in deceiving. My view is simple. I'm just asking, one second. All I asked was, did God deceive? Yes or no?
Shabir, excuse me. I would be extremely surprised if what you were trying to do by picking two words in an entire statement is similar to what I did. When you brought in the idea of Durus,
thank you admitted
when you
I'm
brought
so glad.
In, when you brought in the idea of Durus, I was willing to expand on the context.
Arul.
Get into the fact that this has to deal with Muhammad.
Arul, no.
A couple of his wives and so on. That is, I was willing to expand on the context, which you weren't willing to
Arul,
do.
No, you are Shabir. Not aware of what I was saying. So
Shabir,
let's decide on
do
what.
Do you have an answer?
Let's decide
for the
on what.
Shabir, okay. Shabir, decide.
Arul. Forget all that. You are speaking to Shabir. I'm telling you now. Listen. Let's just quickly agree. We need to drive 200 miles.
We need to go
a
long way.
Let's agree on a subject matter and don't move the goalpost next time we come.
I did not move.
Yes, you did.
I disagree with you.
Yes, you did. I said legal elements right across. New Testament included.
Check out.
Did we touch the New Testament?
New Testament. I will tell you precisely what Jesus
said. No, don't tell me. I just asked.
In regards to oaths, I can tell you that.
God forbid. No problem, inshallah. Look, Shabir. Anything on two words said, please do forgive me. That was not the intention at all. But what we do,
not at all, Arul.
But what we do, next time we have, let's talk on the Bible and the Quran in the context of what the Creator is. Remember, not the created
very,
entity.
Very wide area.
We have done this already.
Even last time.
Okay, I tell
check
you what.
Check out your video.
I tell
I
you what.
I already mentioned this is a wide area.
Then can you, can next time, can
choose
you speak to the Torah? And the Quran.
No, choose a couple of
why not?
I'm answering already.
Okay, go ahead.
Choose a couple of specific attributes.
Okay.
And they in themselves are oceans, and that is why my suggestion is: if you want to exchange contact details, absolutely, that's wonderful.
That's
so
exactly
we can
what I'm going
precise,
to do.
Well
in
done.
That way,
so we can precisely even describe the wording.
Thank you,
the
Arul.
Proposition.
Give me the thing and we'll agree with it and then we'll put it up so everybody knows.
Yeah.
In that way nobody can think we are playing quick ones.
Can you give me your ask him to sign.
No. What
I saw
the oh, sorry, brother. Yeah.
He did not use the word Bible. He kept repeating the word
Torah.
And Tanakh,
yeah, I know. It's okay.
What,
Arul, what's your contact number?
What is one the Tanakh
contact number?
No, if you give me your...
It's the card. You've just been given one.
Yeah, so shall I give you my contact?
Please,
email?
Yeah?
Yeah,
oh, that's fine. Email.
Yeah. Yes, of course, we had the discussion with Shabir there. Apologies again. It turned out to be not exactly how I would have liked it to be, I think. But we did discuss some matters. I think he might have genuinely misunderstood the topic. I'm not sure. But regardless. He did deviate, but maybe he thought we were discussing a topic which he wasn't prepared for, whatever. In any case, the point is not to catch him off guard. We could discuss this again.
Yeah.
Even when a person is well prepared, we still think Islamic Allah is a polar opposite to Yahweh of the Bible.
Absolutely.
And I'm sure when he is well prepared, when the proposition is clearly defined, we would again find that same thing to be true. And that is where I think all of us would be forced to evaluate who the true God is. Obviously, they're not the same.
They're not the same.
So, someone somewhere has to be a fake God.
Absolutely.
And that is something which would be forced upon people to think about.
Absolutely.
And yeah, that's the challenge. And yeah, hopefully next time we'd have a more informed debate.
Yeah, and the challenge will continue, more debates, and the false Allah will be exposed.
Well, praise the Lord. Absolutely. Yeah, by God's grace. For the sake of all human beings, we want human beings to be saved.
Yes.
Human beings are the beneficiaries in the conversation.
Of course.
They are friends. It's only
salvation.
Yeah, absolutely. Deception and so on is what we are up against, not against human beings. Human beings are friends. We want all of us to be saved and come to the Lord Jesus Christ. So God's richest blessings to you.
And to all the viewers.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you very much. Bye.